Hello again, everyone. Welcome back to this series on Yi version 2. And in this video, I want to look at the ways in which you display related data to the user. Now, to explain that more clearly, let's look at an example of something that we already have in our demo system. So in the database, we have a book, and that book has a column called author ID. And author ID has a foreign key to the ID of the author table. So that's all fine in the data domain. That's correct. That's how it should be. But think of it from a user's point of view. If a user is editing a book, they don't want to see an ID number. What they really want to see instead is perhaps a display name in the case of an author, perhaps some other information, but something that is actually usable to a human being rather than just a pure ID number. So if we look back at our project and we look in the models folder, we've already seen our book and we already know that Yi has automatically generated this relationship for us to get the author. The other thing that we mentioned in a previous video was that this author class is not created automatically when the book model is generated by Yi. And so what I've done is I've gone and I've created an author model based on the author table. So those two exist now. But if we look at the default way in which Yi displays this information to the user, and in this case it's the update, but it's the same code used for create as well, we'll see that by default author ID is the actual ID field. So this is expecting a number to be typed in. So we could type in 1 and update, and that's fine, that's valid data. But obviously this is not really very usable. People are not going to know what author relates to which ID number. So clearly we need to do something about that. But first we need to look at a different issue, which is what happens if I type an invalid number in here and I press update. What happens is I get an error. And the error is because that value 5 doesn't exist in the author's table. It's an invalid value. But because I haven't added any validation for that in my book model, this is actually failing when it reaches the database, whereas it should obviously fail validation before that. So the first thing I'm going to do is go into my book model and I'm going to add this validator for author ID. And we talked about validators and rules in the last video. This is the exist validator, and as you might imagine, it looks in the target class, it uses that attribute compared to this attribute in the book model, and it makes sure that this value exists in that class, in that model, before it allows you to save it. So by adding that rule back in and saving that, if we now try to do the same thing, we actually get a useful error message. I thought I'd show you quickly what happens without that message, because Yi does have default validation failure messages. And if we try the same thing again, the default message is just author ID is invalid. It may or may not be a useful error message to your users. So often I think it's better to leave these customized messages in and be a bit more helpful to the user. So that now works, the validation works. However, clearly this is still not usable. So what we're going to look at is a very common method of displaying this data in a more useful way, and that is to use a drop-down list instead of a text box. And in the drop-down list, we can display our authors to the user, and they can choose one from a drop-down list, and then it will save the correct value for the ID field for this book. So let's jump back in and we're going to look at the form. And remember we said the form was a partial view. So this form is shared by the create and the update views. So this is where we need to change how that information is displayed to the user. So our first example, if we look here, is we use this class called dropdown, sorry, a function called dropdownlist, which is another function like text input and whatever. And the first argument to dropdownlist is an array of entries to display to the user. Now, in Yi 1.1, there used to be a list helper class, but in Yi 2, we use this array helper, and we use this function map. And we use some syntax, which you'll use fairly often around Yi, which is you start with your model name, you call a static function find, and in this case, you pass all to it. You call the function all, and that will return all records for the author field. And we're then saying that when we get those models back, we want to use the ID for the drop-down list value. And we want to use the first name property of that model to be the display value to the user. And then we've just added some bootstrap classes just to make sure that that displays correctly. So now that we've changed that, if we go back to our form and refresh the page, okay, let's not do that. Let's refresh it that way. So we've still got our original box in here, but now we have a drop-down list. And that drop-down list shows John and Mary, which are the two authors that I've added to the authors table. But again, clearly that's not really what we want to do. It's not really quite enough. And there are two problems with this. The first problem is using author find arrow all, or indeed using this function on any model, means that we're pulling back all properties for every row in that table. So clearly, if we had an author table with 50 or 100 or more rows in it, then you're pulling back a lot of columns, even though we're only actually using the ID and the first name. So the first thing that we want to do to change this, and this is using one of the active query functions, is this line is the same as the line above, except we've added in a select statement before we return the all. And what this does is it still loads a set of author models and it still finds all of them. The only difference is we're now saying that the only columns we're actually going to use are first name, surname and ID, because we want to display the name. In fact, at the minute we wouldn't need to pull back surname because we're not using it currently. But we can do that, and that's just a network saver. Clearly, if we had a lot of authors, we probably wouldn't use a drop-down list. But just in general, we need to be careful just to select the data we need and not just pull back every piece of data for every row in that model, which in some cases could be tens and tens of megs of data. And in this case, we're doing the same thing. We're using the ID as the value and the first name as the display. So that will look exactly the same on the page. The only difference is it's not pulling back everything, it's just pulling back the stuff we need. So that's fine. However, that's still not quite what we want, because really what we want is we want a display name. Because in the case of our author, we notice that we actually have a first name and a surname. So the first name is obviously not enough information to display to the user. And even showing the surname by itself would not be good enough, because surname would not be unique. So really what we want to do is create a display name from first name and surname. So if we look along here, we can say, well, we still need to pull these two back because we're still going to use them. And we still need the ID. But this time we want to display a display name. And the question is, how do we actually do that using this drop-down list class? And it's fairly straightforward. This is another thing that works automatically in Yi. Is if we go into our author class, I've already created this earlier, but if I uncomment it, if we create a function that starts with the word get and then has a name after it, then we can use that like a magic property. And in this case, even though we're referring to it by that name, what Yi will automatically do, if it can't find that as a normal property, it will try adding the word get and function brackets on the end of it to see if it can find it. And in this case, we're simply deriving a display name from the first name and the surname with a space in it. This is obviously a fairly simple example, people might have middle names, you might want to do it slightly differently, but this is just to give you some kind of idea of what you can do. So now we have a display name that's available in here, and in our form we know that we need to pull those two back to get our display name, and we know that we need the ID number because that will be saved in the book class. And so this should now be ready. We save that again. If we go back to this and reload it, we now have a box here that's a lot more useful, that actually has the full names of the people that we want to use. Because it's a drop-down list, the user can't select an invalid entry. So if we save that, then that's all fine. However, if an attacker was to try and send back an invalid number in here to see if he could break the system, we've added that validation as well back in the book model. So that's all going to be nice and safe and solid. So the only things that we might want to do now is on the view page, we want to do something similar, but rather than using a drop-down list, we can just use a text display field with some similar syntax. And again, on our list here, rather than author ID, we want to do something with the display name. But as you can see, it's a fairly simple thing to do. You use a drop-down list, using the field function, you tell it what model and what property you're actually working with, and then the drop-down list function itself, drop-down list function has an array helper map, which is the function that basically takes all of your data, in that case everything in author, we're selecting a few columns, and then we tell it what fields, what properties of that model we're going to use for our drop-down list, in this case ID and display name, and then these are just additional options that are passed to drop-down list which will be rendered. So hopefully now you understand quite easily how you can add related data to your forms very easily. And if we were to open up the database and have a look, we would see that that value is actually set correctly inside the database. But when it comes to actually updating these, we've modified this form now to show the author. Obviously, what we would then do is we would delete that one, so that we don't have the number box as well. And then we could also change the label of that. We could do that in a couple of ways, but the most obvious way is to rename the label for author ID and just change it to say author instead. So that would be in here. We would change it down here and say, I don't want author ID. Every time this is displayed, I just want it to say author. And then if we refresh that, it says author instead. So, yep, that's that. It's fairly straightforward, like I say. If you've got any questions or comments, then please put them in the comment section below. And I look forward to seeing you all again in the next video.